good to be with you. Would you stand up on your feet with us this morning? You know, the Bible says, come, let us worship and bow down. Let's bring thanksgiving and praise to our Savior because he is worthy. So let's put our hands together like this as we sing praise to him. Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet.
Stay standing. My name is Larry, one of the pastors here. So glad that you're with us today. If this is one of your first times, I want to give you a big welcome right now. If you're with us online, maybe taking a peek through the window, checking this place out, so glad that you are here. We would love the opportunity to connect with you. We actually have a connection card. And if you would take a moment during the service today, fill that out. And then you can either put it, if you're in the room, there's boxes out in the lobby that are black boxes. You can put it in there. Or if this is one of your first, second, or third times with us, man, we would enjoy the opportunity to get to know you and do a couple things. One, give you a gift, popcorn, because that's important. We all like popcorn. And secondly, we'd like to give a gift on behalf of you. So if you brought somebody today, Would you allow them to do that? If you came here by yourself, would you allow us to give a gift on behalf of you? One of our values here is generous living. And we figured rather than giving you something that you don't really want yet, we'd like to give you something that you can do and we can do through you. So we got a couple organizations that are local and global that we partner with that are doing good, good work. And you can pick which one those are. So you just take this connection card over to them. They'll hook you up and let you know which organization you can pick and then go on from there. So glad you guys are with us today. We are going to continue in our time of worship. So let's get it.
Awesome. Well, we're going to enter back into a time of worship, my friends. So here at Northgate, we understand that God is good. He is faithful. He is worthy of a song and worthy of praise. So I want to encourage you guys this morning to just lift up a mighty voice, put your hands together for the God today.
We'll see you break down every wall.
God, we are grateful and we thank you that you are worthy of our praise. God, we thank you that you never leave us nor forsake us, that we can confide and put our full confidence in you and who you are. Blessed assurance, and Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. And born of his spirit, and washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. So I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior.
That's why. Somebody we can trust him with everything. We're gonna sing one more song this morning. We're just gonna declare some names for Jesus, such as Adonai or Elohim, another name for God.
Adonai, Elohim, great I am, lives in me.
Together.
Your name is great and greatly to be praised. Your name is great and greatly to be praised.
pray for us this morning. God, thank you. Thank you, God, that you are worthy. You're worthy of it all, Father. Thank you, Father, that we can sing these truths, God, that we can say that we can trust you, Father. We can trust you, God, in everything and with everything. God, would you just continue to show us your character today? Show us more glimpses of you, God, through the message today and through these truths that we sing in these songs, Lord, that you would draw near to us today, Father. You are a good God, and man, do we need you. So it's in your name, everybody says, amen.
All right, friends, you can have a seat. I get to talk to you about generous living as a response in the midst of your worship, and today I brought my wife, Michelle. For those of you who met her, this is Michelle. Hello, love.
Hello.
Yeah. Hey. Why did I bring her up here? Well, you know, I don't want to just be up here and talk about how we should be living generous lives, and then you're like, do you do it? Right? It's not just something I'm going to ask you to do. And we have our own giving testimony and our own journey. And one of the things that we teach around here is that you should give something. So if you're not giving anything, we're like, just give something. Start somewhere. And it can be as little as a dollar, and it's partnering things. And then we talk about how we should start then giving consistently, or it's a plan and it's a percentage, or when you get paid, or on a specific basis consistently. And then from there, we talk about giving abundantly. And so we're going to talk about that just a little bit. Giving something happened a long time ago for us, and because it's we saw that a faith community that we are part of were important, and the work that they were doing was important. And so for us, it did start with something. And it even started with something individually before we even were married or we were dating. That was something that we were experiencing in separate faith communities where we were just giving something and partnering with a community. And then once we got married, or even when we were dating and conversations started happening about what our priorities were and what was important to us, we started having the conversation about giving consistently. So what does that look like?
Right. So we decided once we got married that we needed to sit down and figure out our finances and what we were going to do with that. And the decision that we
made... What are we going to do with all this money? Like, oh, my gosh, you're so lucky.
The little bit
of money we had. I work in a church.
And so
you're a school teacher.
Yeah, it was, how do we manage this money that we have? And deciding that we were going to commit to give consistently to the church, and that the church needed to live, so we would give to the church to live, and then after we committed... gave what we had committed to give, then we would live on what was left. And so that meant every paycheck, the amount that we had committed went to the church, and then we had what was left. Sometimes that meant giving up a night out or coffee or something else, but we still lived. And
I love that word they actually use, is it was commitment. We want to make sure that the church and what it was doing for the community and in and through it lived first.
Right.
Because we felt like, well, we can adjust what we live on much easier than it can. And like you said, there was times where it was like, this is no worries. And there was other times where it was like, oh, we're not going to do that because something else is living on our behalf. And so that's important. So that was really a big priority. And at times it was easy. At times it was really difficult. And then that other thing that we talk about is giving abundantly. So for us, like, how do we make a decision on where we give abundantly to? So we're already making sure something else lives. And we're living, and we're making sure we're really leaned into that. And then, like, what comes up that makes us decide, that's going to get abundance.
And those are the things that break our heart. Those
100%.
Are the things we give abundantly to.
So that's really a question for all of you, too. And we talk about this here, is what breaks your heart? That's usually where we respond in abundance. So what is it for us?
So for us, it has been kids that don't have families, that don't have enough. So,
not our kids that don't have,
our
but like
kids.
other
kids. That for us started with sponsoring children in other countries. And so we had two kids when we started doing that. So we sponsored two kids. And then when we had another kid, we sponsored a third kid. And now we have four kids. So we sponsor four kids to make sure they have education, food, clothes, shelter, all the things that they need.
Yeah.
And then our kids have abundance as well. So then we can give other things too.
Yeah. It wasn't like just seeming like, well, we got to make our kids live. So now we're a family of 10. It's awesome. But it's abundance. and it's deciding, hey, that's what breaks our heart. And there's other things that come up, just like it come up for you, that, you know, we ask everyone to come alongside of or be a part of that's important to us, where we see that and we're like, hey, that's really important to us. And it breaks our heart, and it's something that we want to see really move forward if we could just lean in a little bit and change for a moment the way that we live so it can really live and thrive and live abundantly as well for good and for the kingdom. So that's a little bit of our giving testimony. There is all kinds of ways for you to give and to partner, so just start with giving something. Those of you who are ready, start giving consistently. Decide that this is going to live. The things that are happening in and through you at this place in this faith community, those of you who are new, it's completely funded and supported by you. There is no outside organization that partners with it. We get to do this good work because of God in and through you. And then give abundantly. Decide what breaks your heart and be like, man, I'm leaning in towards that so we can see more of that happen in my lifetime, whether I'm a part of it or not, just to see it. So ways to give, all kinds of ways. You can do it Venmo, Zelle, envelopes that you got there, you're going to figure it out. You can go knock on a door. You can give, there's boxes in the back of the room. You can do that online. Set it up for reoccurring if you want to. So thankful for your partnership when it comes to that. Thanks, love, for sharing today a little bit about that. Today, we're hopping into pain and suffering. Welcome to Northgate. It's going to be awesome. Check out this video, and then we'll hop into the message.
Pain's a part of life.
I think some people believe it's a test of your faith, but if you don't have a faith to believe in, it kind of makes you wonder why is there suffering in this world?
It was a reason why he took them. Maybe he needed some angels up there to protect, to help him in the fight against the devil.
A baby is a beautiful, wonderful thing. Why doesn't he want me to have this?
Bad things are just the way that you see them.
I think God's in everything we do.
Why would anybody want to create people who do horrible things to each other? It doesn't make any sense.
I don't think God's sitting there and saying these people are hurting and maybe I should help them.
I suppose the answers will come. It's just I'm going through a journey right now that's painful.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. Happy Sunday. Okay, so wait, you're all getting ready. You're like, okay, pain and suffering. Here we go. I was driving. It's like God gave me the opening statement here. So I was driving by. If you've seen the billboard that's on the 680 right off of Lake Herman Avenue, and there was a glitch in the billboard yesterday on the one driving towards Benicia. The top quarter of it was gone. And so the phrase was, why does God allow pain and suffering? And it took away the part that says, why does God? So all it said was, allow pain and suffering, come to Northgate. So if you saw that billboard, we're glad you're here. You're a unique kind. If you're like, all right, bring it on. Here we go. So if I didn't say it, my name's Jeff Bachman. I'm one of the pastors on staff. It's a privilege to be here. We are continuing on in our Explore God series the first 2 weeks. If you haven't caught them, I would strongly encourage you to do. Pastor Larry did a phenomenal job in communicating. First, he said that when we have a purpose and meaning based on God's intent and his design, we're going to find that purpose in a deeper sense. So that was 2 weeks ago. And then last week, it was also that if we're open to the possibility of God's existence, then we'll discover that there are actually many indicators of his presence. And so then for today, you know, kind of for time, but also we're not going to go back into those. We've already kind of built a case for those, whether you're still in process in that or not. But we're kind of operating off of the declaration that those are true and that's actually what I believe. And then we're also declaring that there's only, for us to fully understand this idea of pain and suffering, it really comes out of a couple of different ways. One is exactly what we just said, revealing himself, God, through his inspired text and then also his spirit that dwells in us, his nature that he has created, that we're able to see God moving in that, and then others. And I think that's a part that we're going to be introducing today in a couple different ways. When I was in high school, right at the end of my senior year, I don't know where I got this idea in my head, but I was convinced at the point that I graduated that my parents were going to have for me as a graduation present a car. I don't know why. That was just, I'd probably watched too many 90s sitcoms, too many other people. Like, I think I'd watched Saved by the Bell too much, where it was just going to happen. And so I went through the whole graduation season, and everything that I saw pointed to that was what I was going to see. And so I'd be sitting there, and my dad would be flipping through a magazine, and I was like, Honda, huh? Okay. And then I'd look over here, and it was on the TV. I was like, interesting commercial you were watching right there. Hey, what's that? Oh, we're driving by another car dealership. Interesting. Wonder why we're doing that. And so I went through the entire graduation season to the end. And so afterwards, it was graduation. Got out of graduation. I walked into the parking lot fully expecting to see a car with a red bow, and it was nowhere to be found. And I walked around. I was like, well, it must be late. That must be what it is. And so I went to my graduation that party that night, and we had a grad night that night. And I kept like kind of coming around corners being like, car, no car. And then over here, I was like, oh, you know what they're probably going to do? It's going to be a box with a key. That's how they're going to do it. That's how they're going to do it. So eventually, somewhere in the middle of my grad night, my parents gave me my graduation present. And it was a wonderful Bible that I still have actually to this day. And I opened it up, and there was in there a very nice gift with, in fact, if I'm going to be honest, a sizable amount of cash with the intent to put that towards a down payment on a car. And I was disappointed. I mean, high school, right? but I was disappointed. Why? Because I had set my mind towards everything that I had seen was pointing towards an expectation that wasn't fulfilled. And so even though that thing that was happening was very good and right and probably more than I'm going to be giving my kids, frankly, if we're going to be honest, I was disappointed because it wasn't what I was expecting. And I think it's a similar idea when we talk about suffering, not to dismiss suffering, but to say that we have an expectation, and it's frankly fair. It's a fair expectation that things are not only going to go well for us, but if you then integrate our works, the things that we do, added into that we see in Scripture a good God, that things should not only go well, but they should go better the more that I do it. Like that's just, it makes sense. Those are our expectations. But I think it also, to get a full understanding of this, is that we need to go back to the original premise and design of who God made us to be and how he set that up, which I actually would say that it includes, God's design includes no pain and no suffering, but yet that wasn't his end result. That wasn't the goal of what he was doing. That was the byproduct, actually, of this. Genesis 3:8, it says that then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. You get the sense, as God was created humankind, is that actually his original design was this. It's one word. It's this one up here. It's with. It's with. God made humanity to be with them. And the byproduct in that relationship, in that community, was benefits and blessings, which we said no to. But that communion that is what he was creating us for. In fact, he even goes so far as to then say, it's not good for man to be alone, so he makes a helper and they live together. God has wired us to be with. Both of which, in that idea of community, help to then give a sense for suffering and to also, at different points in time, mitigate it. And so today, we're going to be looking at a person by the name of Job. He has an entire book of the Bible devoted to him. And in this account, we are going to see a man that Job trusted God because God was with him. And in fact, what we will see is that it wasn't God's proximity or relationship which caused the suffering. In fact, Job used that as a way to run to and cry out to instead. Job is a man that he started his life with God, and then he ended his life with God, and there was an enormous process that went along on the way. In fact, the question is asked early on in Job. It said, would Job remain faithful if everything that he had was taken away from him? And we see through the life of Job, the answer is yes, but it was absolutely painful, and he didn't waver. And what I will tell you today is that I stand up here, and I would say I did not want to give this message because I feel like anything that I say, not knowing exactly where you're at in your process, feels dismissive. Because we've all read the poster in Hobby Lobby or seen the pillow, right? God is with you in this, and consider it joy when you face trials of many kinds. And so anything I feel like that I'm going to say is dismissive of that, and I'm not thrilled about that. But what I will say is that in my deepest and darkest moments of pain is what I see is God's character and his nature remain faithful and true. And that's what we learn from Job as well. But I want you, as we're going through this, I want you to look for a couple words. The first of these two words that you will see if you read through the book of Job, it's this. It says, and yet. And yet. It's a turn that you will see in many different phrases and in different chapters in Job. It says, and yet. Where Job very eloquently describes the circumstances and the situation he's in. And yet I will trust in you. Look at Job 13. In fact, it says, though he slay me, and yet I will hope in him. There is a resolve and a heart in acknowledging the situation and the circumstances he is in, and yet God remains faithful. So let's jump into this and look at Job. Job 1:1, good place to start. It says, in the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God, and he shunned evil. If you were to continue reading on, you were to learn a few things about Job, that he was richly blessed. He was a faithful man of God who was considered upright and holy. He was a man who not only was so holy that he wanted to impart his holiness on his children. We also learn pretty quickly on that Job was, as they say in Scripture, loaded. He was loaded. He had an enormous amount of wealth to him. He had land and servants. That wasn't what Scripture says. I added that in myself. Everyone's like, I've never seen that phrase before. And what we discover very quickly in Job 1 is that starting off in verse 6 all the way through 22 is that there is a stripping away of all of these different parts. In fact, it says, in starting in 6, it says, and right after this, meaning this, is that he finds out about something that is happening to him, and then right after this, something else is happening to him. Have you ever had days like that, lives like that, seasons like that? Whether it's at work or at your house, or even if you're like, I've had that when I'd be working at a cash register or something, is that you're serving somebody and they come up to you and they're not pleased. And you're like, oh man. And then the next person comes up and you're like, I'm not even done with your problems and I can see you have plenty of problems. And that's what we see here. In fact, it goes a little something like this, is that Job discovers that he has lost all of his oxen and his donkey and his servants, and then they start lining up, and then it says, and right after this. So he hasn't even gotten all of the information about what he's lost. And right after this, he loses his sheep and his servants and his camels and more servants. And right after this, he loses his 7 sons and his 3 daughters. And I know, because I've been there in that season of my own, not losing this much, but I've been in those places where you feel like it just doesn't stop. And you're like, I don't know how much more of this I can take because it just keeps coming. And it doesn't say right after this, but in the next chapter, he then becomes gravely ill. Let me read for you this list. He gets sores, itching, degenerative facial skin, loss of appetite, depression, loss of strength, worms in the boils, difficulty in breathing, foul breath, loss of weight, continual pain, peeling skin, and fever. Yeah, doesn't that sound like that list of side effects of a new medicine sometimes? Now, let's have a moment of honesty here, and you don't have to raise your hand for this, but is it just me, or when you look at this, is there almost a sense of relief sometime in this of saying, at least I'm not alone? That there, misery loves company. And for me, what I know is that in my darkest moments, I actually don't want to climb out of the pit that I'm in. I'd rather pull you down in with me. And so then when I watch your life falling apart around me, I go, at least I'm not alone. Because it's easier to watch you suffer than to change my heart and my attitude towards what God is doing in my life. And yet, here's what we will see in Job's response. You know what his response is? He mourns. He mourns because he has lost everything that he has held dear. He mourns because he is now a shell of the person that he used to be. He mourns. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that you can't mourn. And I think, and whether it's that we portray this as followers of Jesus or that there's just, again, that expectation that I've got to shine you on and tell you that everything's good, But what we see Job do is that he mourns because it is awful what he has experienced. Job 1, 20 and 21, he says at this point, Job got up and he tore his robe and he shaved his head, a sign of mourning. And then he fell to the ground in worship and he said, naked I come from my mother's womb and naked I will depart. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Early on in my marriage with my wife, we decided that I never felt like I was going to be ready to have kids. But about 3 years in, we said, you know, it's time for us. We'd like to start having a family. And what I didn't realize is that the next 2 years would take us on a journey of more pain than I think I've ever experienced in my life. Not understanding why, but that for some reason, we weren't able to have kids. And I remember each month that we would sit there and look at each other and she would just go, nope. And I'd watch through tears, trying to fix this thing for her and for us and not having a good reason. It was actually a season we were standing at a church and we were singing this song, the Lord gave and the Lord takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. And I got to be honest, is that there were times that I was singing this through tears running down my face and my teeth were gritted and I don't even know if I believed it because I didn't know if there was ever going to come a day that I would get to experience this thing that I so desperately wanted. Because the truth is, I can want kids all day long, and just because God loves me, that doesn't mean that I'm going to get that. That's never been promised. I don't see that anywhere. And I can also want that, but I can recognize that just because God is a good God, he isn't going to give me everything I want. I'd like to think I'm a decent parent, and I don't give my kids everything that they want because I see something different. I know more. I understand that they shouldn't get everything. And I know that God is a good God who gives wonderful gifts. And yet there's a perspective that I, as his son, will not understand sometimes. And yet I don't want to be dismissive of that because I recognize the pain. But what I see in Scripture is that when Paul says to live is Christ and to die is gain, then there's got to be something more than me just accumulating stuff and me having everything that I want. When Paul says that the best thing is actually on this side of where we're at right now, that you will experience the depth and the richness of life when we get Jesus, then sometimes the things that I want or what I'm experiencing may not be what's best for me. And that doesn't always comfort us because it's really hard. And as you would expect, Job's family and his friends come around them and try and give a sense of direction, hope, and purpose, because that's just what friends are like. His wife even says in Job 1, 9, and 10, his wife says to him, are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die. He replied, you are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble? There's a human desire to make sense of pain. I think that's natural. And there are times that you can and you should. If there are things that are happening to you, hear me clear. If you can stop things from happening, that is not a punishment of God. And so if there are things that you can step out of, you don't deserve that, then you should change those things. And yet what I also see in Scripture is that the rain falls on the righteous and the wicked. And so there are going to be times and seasons where you may be experiencing pain and something you don't deserve, and yet it is there. His friends come alongside him. Job 2, 12 and 13 says that when they saw him from a distance, they could hardly recognize him. They began to weep aloud and they tore their robes and they sprinkled dust on their head. Then they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and 7 nights, not saying a word to him because they saw how great his suffering was. Even in the pain, the people wanted to be with him. Have you ever had a friend who has gone through something, a loss, a pain, a suffering, and your desire is, you're like, I need to be there. I need to be with them. I believe that is an attribute of God that you are living out and saying, I want to go sit with them. I want to be with them, and I don't even know what I can do. And we see that his friends do a few things. One is that they wept aloud with him. That there is something in joining them and saying, not manufacturing, but saying, you are hurting, and so I will hurt too. And so they wept aloud together, showing that the emotional shock and sorrow, and then they too tore their robes, indicating that their hearts are broken for the things that are breaking Job's heart. And then they end with the dust on their heads, a deep sense of grief. And what you'll see after 13 is that after the silence is that this group does what all of us sometimes want to do is that they want to try and fix the situation, which is natural. Because I think for many of us, we don't necessarily even sometimes want to get out of suffering. We would just want to know why. You're like, if I am suffering, I just want to know why. If you'll give me a sense of why this is happening and when it's going to be done, then I can put up with anything. I can do anything for 10 more minutes, 10 more hours, 10 more years, if you'll just tell me why. And sometimes we don't get that. Early on in my marriage, I learned that I'm a fixer. And so my wife would come home and she would talk about her day or an experience that she had. And she'd talk about the fight she had with a friend. And I'd sit there and listen for a second. And I was like, oh, well, you know what you need to do? You need to do this, this, and this. Bop, bop, bop. And I wrap it up in a little bow and I'd go like, where are we going to dinner? That didn't go so well. I not only fixed it, but I could fix it quick. Because I'm really, you know, I'm a professional Christian, so I can fix these things for you. I learned quickly after that, after much apologizing, that there were times that she did want me to help fix something, but then there were times that she just wanted me to listen. And actually, I'd take that one step further and say that at points, she doesn't even want me to listen. She just wants me to be with. Would you just sit with me? I don't have anything to say. There's no more words. I've made sense of what's going on in my life. I just don't want to be alone. And not just for my wife and not just for people in my life, but I think that this is true for us, that we see in James, he says, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking in nothing. So then again, there's this sense that things are not done yet, that God is doing something. And if to live is Christ and die is gain, there is a process. We have our own construct of time. And so God is working out something that my words are not going to fix for her or anyone else. And that there is a process. And actually, the longer that we sit in it sometimes, it's going to refine and change not only who you are as a human being moving forward, but then the relationship that you also have with God. Because again, if the end result is getting more stuff and having an easy life, then we are going to be wildly disappointed. Because what I see is God allows very ordinary people to go through extraordinary circumstances all throughout Scripture. So we are not the first ones. David was called to slay a giant. Moses was called to free the slaves out of slavery. Gideon was asked to defeat a massive army. All those were asked, and you could look at that and say, there's no way that they can do that. They will experience troubles, trials, and oppositions. And in fact, what I see in Scripture is sometimes the closer we get to God, not that God will make us experience more of that, but because of our relationship, we will experience that because of the proximity to the people who are opposed to that. How many of you have heard this phrase that's up on the screen? God won't give you any more than you can handle. It's located in Second Hesitations. It's gonna. That's not true. That is not a true statement. I think whether we believe this to be true or not is that it's ringing somewhere in the back of our head. God will not give you any more than you can handle. And for us as Christians, that we look at people and we go, hey, just so you know, God won't give you any more than you can handle. And my friends, what I will tell to you right now, that is an absolute lie. I actually believe God will allow you to experience exactly what you can handle and then some. Not to test you, but to allow you to come back to a place of saying, my dependency is fully on you. What I see is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, where it says, to trust in the Lord with all of your heart, lean not on your own understanding, in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will lead your path straight. Nowhere in there does it say, hey, God's not going to break you. That's not what I see here. And so then there are going to be times you are in seasons of an experience where we are called to absolutely cry out to who God is. And it's not always linear and it doesn't make sense. And I'm sorry for that. But what we see is A plus B does not always equal C. So then there is an element of trust in this. We can bring reason and sense. We can provide ways to get out of some of pain and suffering. And then there's also going to be just a sense of trust that God is up to something that on this side of heaven we may not see. We see God at some point in talking with Job, he turns. And it's not this dialogue and it's not allowing Job a chance to process. He gives him the full measure of who God is. My kids know that. When I'm talking with them is that there's a time where we're sitting here talking and debate and then I'm like, clean up your rooms, we need to do this. And all of a sudden my voice changes to where they know that it's not a debate anymore. is that I have asked you to do something and you will do that thing. Or you will be very lonely in your room for many, many nights. And we see almost that tone and that switch. If you haven't spent much time in Scripture, if you don't think that God's funny or sarcastic, like, check this out. But I don't think he's fed up with Job, but he's just at the point of saying, I need you to listen. Job 38, 4 through 7 says it like this. He goes, where were you when I laid out the earth's foundation? I'm so sorry. Tell me if you understand. Who marked it off the dimension? Surely you must know, Job, right? Who stretched a measuring line across it, or what were its footing set? Or who laid its cornerstone while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? It's like, I'm so sorry. Can you remind me who was? Oh, it was me, not you. And I'm sorry that you don't fully understand this, and I get that, and thank you for the pain, and I understand that. But there's something going on that I'm doing that's not only a refining process in you, but there's an entire universe. And then he goes a little bit farther and he says this. He goes in verse 40, or chapter 40, verse 7, he says, brace yourself like a man and I will question and you shall answer. In another translation, it says to gird your loins. My translation of that is put on your big boy pants, because we got some talking. These are my big boy pants, by the way, today. Put on your big boy pants, because there's going to be a season where you're going to have to understand or trust me in what I am doing. And I think what this dialogue between Job and God reveals is this, is that our expectations reveal much about what we think we deserve. And here's what I'm going to tell you, my friends. God is not your co-pilot. We have been invited unto a seat on his bus, and he is driving. And the more that we can understand his nature and his character comes then to a place of us aligning our expectations to who he is and what he is doing. And these experiences that he's doing in Job are sometimes bigger, and that there are blessings, and that there are times that he is beyond uncomfortable. But in this season right now, what we see all throughout Scripture is that there may be a season where all that is wrong is not to be made right yet. And why? Sometimes we can give you a why for that, and sometimes I don't know. Jesus even talks about that. He teaches a parable, which is a story that he teaches stories to get people to understand, but that there's a heavenly meaning in that. Matthew 13, 24 through 30 says it this way. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of God is like a man who sowed good seed in the field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. And what I want to pause there for just a moment is to say, just to be clear, there is an enemy among us. There is a battle of good and evil that's spiritual that we can't see. There is a battle for your souls. There is a battle for this earth. And there is a battle of evil and good, God being fully good. And there is that battle that we even see that at the start of Job in a debate and dialogue as far as the permission that God even gives to Satan. But we live in a world that is broken because of our separation between us and God. Continuing on, it says, when the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, sir, didn't you sow good seeds in the field? Where did the weeds come from? An enemy did this, he replied. The servant asked him, do you want us to go and pull them up? No, he answered, because while you are pulling up the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. The sense that he's saying, the wheat needs to continue to grow. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned, then gather the wheat and bring it to my barn. Which to me, I see this, and it's this. It's we live in a broken world with broken people interacting with broken people. And that equals sometimes, at points and times in our own faith and in our journey, is a lifetime of missed expectations. Do you know that many of the sufferings that we experience here on this earth could be solved by humanity? Not all of them, but many of them could be solved. And I was more reminded of that than ever yesterday morning when I woke up and I was doing some message prep for this and I saw the travesty that's happening over in Israel right now. And just because somebody is doing something in the name of God does not mean that God endorses that. Let's be clear. God has provided us, humanity, so many earthly resources, and it is oftentimes our humanity that chooses not to distribute those in a way that allow other people to experience comfort and goodness. And oftentimes we look at that and we say, well, that's God's fault. And God's like, I gave you this. Broken earth, broken people, broken people. See, and here's what we see at the end here. Jesus demands fair and right as well. However, he sees the whole picture, and so it's happening in a time and a speed and a space that sometimes we are not comfortable with. But let me assure you of this. In all of this, Jesus, for now, Jesus is with us. It's where we get that word Emmanuel. My translation is witness. Jesus, Emmanuel, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. There is a sense that Jesus coming with us, and that with is in the pain. That with is in the suffering. It's in the joy as well, but that's not what we get to talk about today. It's that in everything that we are experiencing, Jesus is with us, and he desires and demands that same sense of fair and right. It's just not today. And so here's what I tell you. God hears you. I promise. It doesn't feel like it, and there have been seasons where I too sit there and wonder through my prayers and my tears and my supplications, my asking, as I just go, how much longer, God? I need to make sense of all this. And what we see is God saying is that he will make all that is lost new and restored, and that there will come that point. There, we will get to experience Matthew 13, 30. It's just not today. You know, I found this interesting. I was reading up on just some different parts in this week. You know, there's two things that God collects. Two things. One, in Psalm 56, it says that he collects our tears in a bottle, and he holds them. And then what I see in Revelation is that he collects our prayers, and it says, at the right moment, he will take those and he will pour them out, distributing them. That all of those prayers that we have given, all the things that we feel like maybe a no or a not yet or a maybe, all of a sudden come and they are yes and amen. And God saying, I see your tears. I hear your prayers. It was not empty. I promise you that. It's coming. It's just not today. And so there will come a day that we will experience the full weight and measure of who God is, where he will then both distribute his full love and his full mercy and his full truth and his full judgment. Those will all come. And that word judgment, everyone goes, oh, judgment. But here's what I know is for those who demand vindication for the things that have been wrong, that they have experienced divorce and injustice and sickness and pain and unemployment and addiction and all those that they've experienced those, is that for all of those, when I say justice, you say yes, please. Jesus sees that and he hears you and it will come. And on that day, it will be like cold water to a scorched, dry person. As you talk to people who have experienced significant pain and loss, on this side of heaven, it doesn't go away. It changes. It morphs. It refines. We had some friends that 15 years ago, they lost an infant to SIDS. And as you talk to them 15 years later, it's not that they've forgotten about their child. They have seen God's faithfulness in this. They have experienced a proximity to Jesus that they may not have experienced had they lost their son. They don't delight in that. And it does. It stays with you. But it also does, through Jesus, get better. Job, what we see at the end of Job is that he gets double what he has back. He gets twice as much cattle, twice as much land, twice as many servants. He gets new kids back. And yet, we all know that that doesn't mean that replaces what was lost. And so then we take the full measure of who God is and what he is doing in our life. And I see it in Psalm 23, 1 through 4. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for the namesake. Even though I walk through the darkest valleys, I fear no evil. Why? Because you are with me. God's with you in this. And on this side of heaven, you may not see a full restoration in what we would choose. But what I know is in this life, all of it. You must have. If you're sitting here as some form of a fully alive human, you have experienced the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. And I know in all of that pain and suffering, and all of that joy and celebration, is that God is with you in every bit of that. And in every bit of that, that he sits and he delights in your joy and he cries and mourns with you in your tears, is that we get the sense that it's that what we are living right now, there is something bigger beyond that. Job 42, 1-3 says it this way. Then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. Hold on to that phrase, too wonderful for me to know. That there are days that you have to, through every bit of who you are, is you have to scream that out. And yet God is with you in that. He's with you in the deep resolve and the trust of saying, God, you are too wonderful for me to know. I don't feel it right now. And yet I will reside in that. And you will see, feel, and experience all of who God, that's what this life is. But what God is aiming us towards is a life that is too wonderful for us to know. And what we are promised as we trust in God is comfort and hope. It will get better, I promise. Hold on. And you're not alone in this. Not only with the witness of God, the Emmanuel, Jesus coming and living a life so that we could be with God, but knowing that you're not alone, even on your darkest days. And what I believe is community is at their best. I think other than Jesus, it's what I fight for here at this church. Community is at its best when they go, I don't know what to say. I have no way that I can fix this. And I'm going to sit down right next to you. And I think that the final reminder that we get, and it may be a little bit morbid or a sad way to land this, is that Job 42:17 says it like this. So Job died, an old man and full of years. My friends, this isn't it. This isn't it. There is more to come. And for us to sit here and establish God's goodness based on what we have experienced is short-sighted of what is coming. How do we see Job respond? And yet I will. We need to. Our posture should be one that is actively present in this life and all that it offers. So my friends, do not miss it. Don't miss what he is doing and what he's up to, but understanding that it's also pointing to something so much greater. And so Father, we end our time in your word almost feeling a little unresolved of saying, I don't necessarily know if that answers why I can't find a job, or why I feel so alone, or why I continue to be addicted, or any of those. And yet, God, would it start with understanding who you are? Not taking our eyes and our focus off of us in the sense of not complaining about it, but God, that we're actually bringing those things to you. Saying, God, if you're with me, then you're with me in everything that I'm sitting in right now. And he says, exactly. God, may we experience your Emmanuel. May we experience your nature and your character, too wonderful for us to know. Amen.
You guys may stand to your feet as we enter into a time of worship in response to the message.
God proved your faithfulness. I've seen miracles my mind can comprehend. And there is beauty in what I can't understand.
Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. The wonder-working God, you're the wonder-working God. All the miracles I've seen, you're too good to not believe. You're the wonder-working God, and you heal because you love. All the miracles we'll see, you're too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. And I can resurrect a man with my own hands. Just the mention of your name can raise the dead. So all the glory to the only one who can. Jesus, it's you.
Because you love, all the miracles we'll see.
So friends, don't rush out of here today. I think it's important actually for you to sit in the moment of all of this. Maybe just take a deep breath in the midst of it. Jeff did a beautiful job talking about this and really summarizing our theology around here. And it's a statement that we make often, and that is that there is nothing so broken in your life that God cannot do a mending work in. If you just allow him. Like Jeff said, there are things on this side of eternity that will not change, that will not heal up completely, but there can be a mending work, and it can start today if you would just allow him. There's nothing so lost in your life, in you, that cannot be found. You will be found by him if you choose so, even today. And finally, there is nothing so dead in your life that cannot be resurrected again. That's what he does. He makes things new. And even today, a new thing in the midst of you, you can be made new. That's what we see him do through Jesus. He makes dead things alive. He'll resurrect something new in you today. If you're ready to begin that journey, if you're ready to step into that space today, we would love to go with you on that journey, invite you into that. We wrote this journal. It's called This Changes Everything. It's 21 days of what does surrender actually look like? What is allowing him to mend things, to find things, and to make things new look like? And so this is just a starter for those of you who are like, okay, I'm in, I don't know what else to do. Here we go. What's the next step? We want to give this as a free gift to you. If you're with us online, you can text TCE1 to 94000, or you can go out to the lobby. If you're here today, on the left over there, there's a This Changes Everything little nook where we'd love to give you a free copy of this, walk with you on that journey. And then something else a little special, we want to give you a light. If you see a big cross on the wall over there, there's light bulbs in there. Those light bulbs represent every single person this year in 2023 that has taken a light and let that light shine in their own lives through Jesus Christ. And they've said yes to Jesus and saying, yes, that's what I want, that's what I need, I'm surrendering that over. And then they've put it in the wall. And so we want to give you that light too, because a light is allowed in your dark place. A light is allowed to do what a light does, to give direction, to give warmth, security, safety, comfort, even in the midst of a storm. Use your own analogy, lighthouse. We want to give you a light. And so may we celebrate you. If you give you a light over there, you can put it in the wall. We have people that would love to pray for you. If you're here today, we have people in the back of the room as you exit here that would love to pray with you in person. And then also, if you're new with us, again, please give us your connection card. Connect with us. Give a gift on your behalf and popcorn, because it's good as you leave something like today. You're like, I need food. So let me send you off with a blessing. We have this posture of giving up and receiving. May you, in the midst of your pain and your suffering and all that the world brings in the chaos, keep your eyes fixed on the light of life and know that you will have pieces of it now and all of it in eternity. Would you be blessed by that, friends? I will see you next week. Love you.